will be moderated by our colleague José Carlos Cabaleiro, and Efren Rama, our colleague Efren Rama, will present his work, his PhD work. So Efren, whenever you want, you can start.
Okay, good morning everyone. I'm Efren Rama. I'm going to present the current state of my thesis right now. So my thesis is in the field of process mining, which is a discipline that allows to extract knowledge by analyzing event logs. An event log is a registry of events that at least a key identifier, an activity, and a timestamp. The event log also has a case ID, which identifies the traces inside the event log, an activity that tells us what is going to be done in the process, the timestamp that tell us when it's going to be done, and the resources that, or other attributes, for example, the resources that tell us who is doing the activity at hand. Case IDs, activities, and timestamps are mandatory in a business process. So from an event log, we can extract a graphical representation of the business process. There are many graphical representations available, such as PetriNets, BPMN, DFGs, or transition systems. In this thesis, we are going to use PetriNets because they are one of the richest graphical languages to represent business process. So PetriNet is basically a bipartite graph with two types of nodes, places that contain tokens that show the current state of the PetriNet in a given time, and then transitions that represent each of the activities of the process. Transitions can be only fired when they have before a list of the places that are filled with a token. When you fire a transition, that makes the tokens that were before the transition to move forward in the PetriNet. Thus, the PetriNet can flow. There is a technique that is called token replay that gives us the transitions activated and the place activations from executing a partial trace of the model. That is, we have a trace and we can retrieve which transitions have been activated by following the series of activities of that trace. We can also retrieve the places that have had a token in the past. So basically, process mining has three subfields. Process discovery that allow us to infer a graphical representation of the event log using a discovery algorithm. Process conformance, where a process model is compared with an event log to check its degree of conformance. For example, we can see how well the process model represents the reality of the log. For example, how well the traces align with the process model, or how much extra behavior the model allows in the process model. And finally, process enhancement tells us how we can improve the event log with the information of the process model. So the focus of this thesis is predictive monitoring that tells us, allows us to forecast how a running case will unfold. This is inside the process enhancement, but it can also use techniques from process discovery and process conformance. So there are some predictive monitoring tasks that are quite interesting. For example, which will be the next activity or series of activities, when will occur the next timestamp, or how much time is left until the end of the case. They can also ask us will be the outcome of the current case. For example, whether a patient in a hospital will be admitted in the future again, or what will be the next attribute value or next sequence of attributes. In the case I presented before, for example, who will be the next resource to make the next activity. We will focus only on the problem of the predicting the next activity. So there are two big groups of approaches. On the one hand, process-aware approaches rely on explicit representations of the process. For example, transition systems, probabilistic finite automation, Petri-nets, etc. There are all graphical representations, and from that graphical representation, we start to build a predictive model that allows us to make predictions. On the other hand, we have non-process aware approaches that build an implicit representation of the process using feature vectors, engineering of the prefix of the traces. These feature vectors are fed up to a machine learning pipeline, and then from that machine learning pipeline, we can start to make predictions. So there are many techniques inside this second group, such as support vector machines, random forest, clustering approaches, factorization machines, and deep learning techniques. Inside deep learning techniques, which one of the most popular groups of techniques of deep learning are recurrent neural networks. And more specifically, LSTMs have the most competitive results nowadays. And this is for one simple reason. Deep learning techniques allows us to look out on the past from the beginning of the partial trace. Whereas the other more classical machine learning techniques have the problem that they need a fixed window of events that are processed in a given time. Even though the recurrent neural networks are very important in deep learning, specifically in predictive monitoring, there are many other techniques that have been used in the literature. For example, convolutional neural networks, memory augmented neural networks, autoencoders, generative adversarial networks, transformers, etc. So basically, a recurrent neural network operates on a sequence of feature vectors, x sub 1, x sub t. From that series of vectors, we iterate using a shared weight matrix, W, right here. And we calculate the hidden state of the neural network on a given time, which summarizes the information from the past up to that moment, that is letter H. So after we make this processing, we can output a prediction. From that prediction, that is fed to a loss function, for example, category cross entropy, that is minimized by using stochastic gradient descent, and thus we can calculate a series of gradients that allows us to update the weights of this shared matrix W. So the basic architecture that I showed here, it is not used in practice because it has the problem of vanishing gradients, which means that the neural network cannot learn. So there are two big groups of approaches, LSTMs and GRUs. In this work, we are going to use GRUs because they are less computationally expensive than the LSTMs, and furthermore, they have practically the same results. So, just a quick moment to explain the most important terms of these equations, because next I am going to modify them to build a new architecture. For example, the most important things are the letter X, with show us which is the current vector that represents the current event, the C gate that show us the gate that controls how many information is going to be updated from the current information, and the reset gate that is going to show us how many information is going to be forgotten from the past. The letter H show us the hidden state of the current model at the moment, and the H tilde is going to show us how the current memory of the neural network in a given moment. U and W are just weight matrices. So the idea of the approach is the following one. Can we leverage information from the explicit process model to this training procedure? So this has a series of advantages if we can manage it. We don't have to learn an implicit process model, and that would allow the neural net to focus on other relationships present in the prefix. Thus, this may help converge to a better solution minima. The solution is to use We propose to use deep learning on graphs. And why? Because deep learning approaches usually work much better on almost raw data, because deep learning are good automatic feature extractors. The other approach would be to build manually a series of feature vectors and feed it to, for example, a feed-forward network or other machine learning approaches. But what we really want is to use raw data as much as possible that represents the current state of the process model in a given time. So, summarizing, we need to get a whole graph that represents the spatiotemporal state of a given prefix, and from that state, we can predict its next activity. That, in terminology of deep learning on graphs, will be a graph-level task. So, in practice, it's really hard to apply deep learning on graphs because graphs are non-Euclidean. That means the graph can have any variable number of nodes, and each node can be connected to an arbitrary number of nodes. So we cannot do like in traditional convolutional neural networks, where we slide a set of filters around a grid matrix. The solution is to use graph convolutional networks. So up to this point, there are two ways to proceed. I can just explain how really a graph convolutional network works and derive where this equation comes from, or just give a brief explanation that it's intuitive and easy to explain. So I'm going to do the second one. In this basic form, a graph convolutional neural network operates on two terms, on a feature matrix X and an adjacency matrix A. A show us tell us how the nodes on the matrix are connected and has dimensions n times n. So n is the time, is the number of nodes in the graph. And X is a feature matrix that for each node of the graph tells us something, more information again of that node. So it has two dimensions, dimension n times f, where f is the length of the feature vector. So there, we cannot apply that expression directly. We need to do two more things. First, we normalize A, because the unnormalized multiplication would change completely the scale of the feature vectors. Thus, we simply multiply the adjacency matrix for the degree inverse square root of the degree node matrix. The degree node matrix just tell us how the number of arcs that come out or in from each node. And another trick we need to do is to enforce subloops. So that for, in other case, we will assume for each node, it's only its neighbors, but not the node itself. And if we don't do that and just apply this normalization alone, we have the problem of vanishing and exploding gradients. That is not really good for the learning procedure. So for that, we just add to the adjacency matrix an identity matrix. That does, we have a self loop for each of the nodes of the graph. So we have the following expression for the undirected graph convolutional neural network. Unfortunately, our graphs are directed. That means that the tokens of the Petri net can only flow in a given direction, and they cannot flow backwards, if not telling explicitly. So we propose to change that normalization by an asymmetric normalization, which is the following one. Instead of multiplying the adjacency matrix for an inverse square root degree matrix, we just must multiply the adjacency matrix for a inverse degree matrix. So the main question that we have to answer is, where do we get this adjacency matrix and the feature matrix? So the adjacency matrix is retrieved from the process model directly, because the process model, as I said before, is a bipartite graph. However, we are not interested in the transitions from the Petri net, because the place movement of the process model is just enough. And thus, if we can delete the transitions from the Petri net, that will reduce the memory consumption by half, practically. So the transistor firing, we can have that information just as an attribute of the node. The attributes of the node, the feature matrix X, is retrieved by doing a token replay of a prefix of the process node. As I said before, the token replay tries to match a prefix and a PetriNet to discover which transitions are activated and which places have or have got a token. So we build an accumulated feature matrix, accumulated because we want to have the information of the current event and past event. So we have to accumulate the information as we are processing the partial prefix. So we have rows that correspond to each of the places of the PetriNet, and for each row we have a column that corresponds with the feature that describes the prefix and event at hand. For example, the ID of the transition that activated the place, the ID of the place, the number of tokens that appeared so far in the place, the activity that really make the transition to fire, because the transitions in the PetriNet, there are two types in fact. There are regular transitions and hidden transitions that are added by the discovering algorithm to improve the fitness, the measures. So these columns are in fact the categorical values in their most part. So we need to assign, we cannot use these categories directly. So we need to assign a fixed learn vector and embedding to each categorical feature, and instead of using one hot encoding, because that allows us to keep the x dimensionality constant and independent of the number of activities of the business process. So after we do the graph convolutional network operation, the output has this dimensionality n times h, where n is the number of nodes of the graph and h is the hidden state we have defined it for the weights. So we have a problem because we want to do a prediction on the dimension of the activities. We have one extra dimension, the dimension of the nodes. So before doing this prediction, which is a projection in fact, we have to apply a summary operation of the learned feature nodes of the graph. That operation is called readout, and is the same operation as the pooling operation, well, very similar operation to the pooling operations of the convolutional neural networks. There are multiple options that, for example, using the maximum of the nodes, the mean of the nodes, the sum of the nodes, or even a weighted average via an attention mechanism. It has been shown empirically that maximum works much better for classification problems and mean works better for regression problems. Since the activity prediction problem is a classification problem, we use the maximum in this work. So the previously shown encoding has a main problem, that is the disencoding overwrites features in loops. For example, if we take into account this model, we have that the information for when we arrive the third A, the information for the first and second A will be completely overwritten by the third A. So one possible solution will be to extend the feature matrix X to take into account this case. But this is not a good solution because we will need much more memory to hold this matrix in memory, and it does not scale well with big loops of the same activity. So we have a lot of loops, like a loop of 40 same activities. We are going to be losing a lot of information with this encoding. So another simple solution would be to apply a graph convolutional network independently along the events of the prefix. So we first apply a graph convolutional network. Then for each event, we perform a readout operation, and then we use that information to feed up to the LSTM that joins the temporal information we have processed before. The problem is that the graph convolutional networks are applied independently, and thus has the problem that they may miss spatial temporal iterations. So the performance of this model is going to be less than desirable. So a simple another solution that can be do in these pretty robots is to apply the graph convolutional network operation while we perform the recurrent neural network operation. We can call this a gated graph recurrent neural networks. So in practice, we just modify the group equations to use a graph convolutional operation inside the linear combination of the inputs, this one, and the hidden state. Using the hidden state as the also with a graph convolutional operation allow us to propagate the information of the adjacency matrix along the time dimension. As I said before, this framework can we use GRUS because it's cheaper to compute, but we can use any recurrent network network operation. For example, we can use this with LSTMs. So the problem with the previous architecture is that the another attributes like resources or timestamps that are not directly tied with the process model poses a bottleneck on the computation of the graph convolutional network operation. So we propose to separate the graph information from other attributes. So we have first a layer that processes the graph and the graph information. And then we fed that information along the attribute information to an LSTM. And thus we have a final model. So the results and conclusions, we have tried this with 12 real life event logs against 8 different state of the art approaches. In fact, there are 9, but the two ones are count as one because it's the same approach but with different inputs. So we have the best result in 5 of the 12 datasets and the second best result in 3 of the 12 datasets. We have subpar performance on 4 of the 12 datasets. But looking at the results like that, it is not a good idea because there are some approaches that work very well for one log and work very poorly on the rest of the logs. So we do a statistical test with Friedman aligned ranks with Holm post hoc, and with that we have a ranking of the approaches on the previously shown datasets. So we in the ranking we show that we are the best approach overall, which means that we work most consistently than the other approaches over a wide range of predictive monitoring of the predictive monitoring logs. So if we compare pairwise the approaches us against others, in this case we are taking the 3 best, we have that we work much more consistently than the other approaches, and the good performance are really good performance, and the bad performance and not so bad performance. If you look at the best one, we have that they have an improvement of the 9.9% and just a loss of 4%. So in conclusion, we have presented a predictive monitoring approach that leverages information from a business process model using a deep learning approach based on graph convolutional networks. So this new approach, performs consistently in a wide array of business process logs. For future work, we intend to experiment with other graph convolutional operations, for example, APPNP or GAT. I mean, the graph convolutional operation that I showed before is really basic operation. There are many other operations that can be used. For example, this one is just PageRank with the graph convolutional operations, and this one applies attention mechanisms instead of a weighted average. We also plan to tackle more predictive tasks, and we also plan to use information about the changes in the process. That means, for example, we can use multiple models and one model or another if a change has happened on the process or not. So here it ends the presentation. If you have any questions.
Thank you, Efrain, for your presentation. Well, I am not an expert in deep learning techniques and also in the in the process monitoring, but well, I think that is a very extensive work in with this topic, and I have only a question that is I think that is the process, the modeling of the process is a graph.
Yeah.
So I guess that it may be a huge graph. So do you apply some technique about graph theory before your approach?
Not really. I mean, the graphs that are result after the processing I told before, the most important part is to delay the transitions, because that, as I told before, reduces the computation memory by half. So in fact, the number of nodes of the graphs, they are in the worst case about 200 nodes, just. The problem is that we use also the time dimension. So the inputs to this model are three dimensional. We have the feature vector dimension, the node dimension, and the time dimension. So 200 nodes, yes, is big to process. But if in reality, we don't use any technique. We use the graph as it is, because the main philosophy of this work is to use that data as raw as possible, or sea, as it is.
Okay. Well, before ask another question, anybody wants to ask something? No? Everything is clear? Okay. Another question is the where is the challenge in terms of computing resource?
Sorry, I don't understand it.
I guess that you have to analyze a lot of futures to involve in the process. So I think that the size of the matrices of features, how more or less, how many, is the size more or less in terms to understand the challenge in computational terms?
Yeah, it really depends on the process log. In the most simple process log, we have traces of the maximum length of 10 cases. But in some other logs, we have traces, we have 500 events. The mean is about 80 events for traces. So we have, imagine, 80, the length of 80, plus the length of the nodes, then maybe 50 or 100, plus the size of the feature vectors that are not an integer but an embedding vector. We have a size of 32. So we have 80 plus 100 plus 32. That is our input matrix, more or less. Plus the batch size, because we have one extra dimension. O sea, we perform not a basic stochastic gradient. We have, when we just train with one sample, we train with multiple samples at once, and we train with 32 samples. So it will really be 32 plus 32.80.100.32.
Okay, because you mentioned memory issues. If I understand well, you have to you start from your previous traces to try to predict the next stage. I mean, you have to execute the process previously several times in order to get information from the traces.
Not really. We have a trace, and for that trace we have a prefix that is a series of events that represent the past, and from that past we need to predict the future, which is the next event. So we use the prefix on the model. We don't do the replay of the whole trace because we don't know that. We only know the prefix, and that's what we use really.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, it sounds interesting and not easy. So, okay. Anyone wants to ask anything?
You have a hand raised, Kaba, from our colleague Felix.
Okay.
Hi, Efren. Okay, I think it's a very interesting presentation, and I congratulate you for your work. I only have an intuitive understanding of what you are doing with the learning techniques, but I have a question which is related with the use of these kinds of algorithms in, for example, in a company or in a health problem, as you are working with, I don't know if you are working with these kinds of problems, but your supervisors are working with these kinds of problems. And it's related with the practical use, because I think this technique will be, not so quick or not so fast as other approaches. But it's possible to apply these kinds of methods, for example, if you are working in a company and you need to get an answer to a problem in a quick time.
Because there are two big stages in the deep learning approach. So we have first the training, which is the really most computationally expensive part. Mm. And then we have the prediction phase. And the prediction phase is usually very fast because we don't have to update the weights of the neural network. We just do a quick multiplication to get a result. And that multiplication can be further optimized using, for example, some more sophisticated libraries, for example, TensorRT, which makes us to get a really fast predicting monetary approach in prediction time. The main problem is the training. So, because it's the most computationally expensive, the prediction phase, which is when we make the model work for us, is really fast.
I'm going to ask another question, but it's related with this one. I'm not sure if it has sense, but if there is some changes in the structure of the process or of the log the company has, the network that you have learned, it continues to work.
Not really. In fact, it is going to be one of the other points that is going to be treated in the thesis. So okay. If the process model changes, the prediction model, it doesn't work. Okay. Because the process model is different. Okay. So if we can detect that on time, we can use different models depending or retrain it online even.
Okay, perfect. Okay, thank you again, and okay, I think that is a very good job.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, if it is there any more questions, we can finish. Thank you, Efrain, for your presentation and your answer to the questions. And continue working like that.
Thank you.